Welcome to this week's edition of Grilling Stafford with Navasota City Manager Brad Stafford, along with the Navasota Examiner and Willie 98.7 FM.
Good morning, Navasota. How's everybody today? Hope you're doing great. How's Anna and Kenny?
We're good, Brad.
Doing great.
Kenny's got on his Willie shirt tonight.
He does.
Got to represent it.
Yeah. All right. Got with us Anna Casino with the Navasota Examiner and Kenny Graves, Real Country, Willie 98.7.
Glad to be here.
Thank you all for joining us. You got any questions today?
Brad, we have a few questions.
You're really grilling me today.
Yeah, that's the plan.
Okay.
Let's get started.
I guess I'm ready. I've been marinating. Marinating.
Okay, are we ready?
Yeah.
Would you explain responsibility for streets and roads in Grimes County? For example, where does City of Navasota responsibility end and Grimes County Road and Bridge Department take over? What is TxDOT responsible for in Navasota? And is TxDOT responsible strictly for state highways and FMs? It's a long.
That is long. the City of Navasota is only responsible for streets inside the city limits.
Okay.
And I know that's confusing for some people because their address says they live in Navasota. However, they do not live inside the city limits. I can't give you the exact, but if you look on our website, it shows where our limits are. Because I get a lot of questions about things. We live in Navasota, and then when I look up, they're out in the county. And then the county is responsible for some of the roads out in the county. There are some private roads in the county. And I'm not going to get into that one because I've been to enough commissioner court meetings and heard enough conversations there. I'll let commissioners or the judge handle that one. And then TxDOT handles all the state highways, Highway 6, Business 6, 105, FM 379, Spur 515, 3090. I think I covered them all. Those are all state, and they don't work on city roads. They don't work on county roads. We can apply for some grant funding that comes through the federal government that would allow some work to go on that seems to be highway work that could happen on our city streets, but that's not a daily occurrence.
Okay.
So there, hopefully that answers
that
question.
I think it did.
It's a good answer. Mm-hmm. Okay, Brad, to follow up on that, do the city and county ever work together on road and bridge work, and how?
We do. Actually, when they want to talk about bridges especially, that's actually a combination of city, county, and state. The state, TxDOT, inspects all bridges in ever so often, and I don't remember that. And then they funnel funding into the county to assist with repairs on those bridges and those type things. And the Road and Bridge Department in Grimes County has been very generous to help us whenever that comes through and we have a bridge that needs work. It really goes through their office. TxDOT funds it. It's not funded by the county or the city, which is all still taxpayer dollars. So we do that. And we work with the county on multiple issues, mm-hmm. not just roads and other things. We don't do a lot of work together on roads. They have plenty to take care of. We have plenty to take care of, and it's really difficult to break away and help each other out on that. But we do a lot of work with the county, and they do a lot of work with us.
Okay. All right. Brad, is it true to say that any grant money Navasota and Grimes County gets from TxDOT is essentially returning our tax dollars and fees back to us?
That's what I would call it. The money that they receive money from the federal government, which is still taxpayer dollars, state money, taxpayer dollars. Any kind of grant that we might get through Department of Transportation could be from taxes on that, on your gasoline, diesel, that type stuff. So, yeah, all grants that we apply for are just getting our money back, the citizens' money back into our community.
All right. How does a city expedite badly needed work on a roadway that is a TxDOT responsibility? For example, do they have to pay up front for anything?
on a TxDOT right-of-way, we call TxDOT and they take care of it. Now, there are projects where we work with TxDOT, like if it's something we want that, you know, it's not a necessity or it's not a in TxDOT's priority list, we may come up and help with some funding or engineering or something. The crosswalk, for instance, on Washington. Mm-hmm. You know, that was not something that was on the radar for TxDOT, and they said, if y'all want to see something happen, if you'll engineer it, we'll build it. So we paid for the engineering, and they'll build it.
Okay. The library is referred to as the Navasota Library, but the county does support the library. Do county residents have the same privileges, pay the same fees, etc., as Navasota residents?
Yes. So it is, you know, it is the Navasota does operate that. They do, the Grimes County does put some funding into it, and it's open to all the citizens of Grimes County to come in, and we don't charge you extra if you're a county resident versus a city resident, because it's for all. Mm-hmm. Grimes County residents.
And the library's doing some really good things, so.
They're doing a lot of great things.
They've been really busy already.
Yeah, there's just a lot of fun that happens down there, and it's great to see the activity and how full it is. I mean, their summer reading program is unbelievable this year.
Yep.
I think she said 75 kids on the first night.
75 kids.
That's unbelievable.
It is.
It's great for them and for the kids.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Bravo. Brad, what can we expect at Sounds of Summer this Friday night?
Zydeco music. Mm-hmm. Zydeco Gators will be here, and we've got food trucks again. You can expect fun, Kenny. That's what we're going to have is fun.
Good.
Great music, great fun, chance to get out and see your neighbors and dance if you want to dance, eat and drink and have fun and just enjoy a nice evening in downtown Navasota.
Perfect. Brad, Navasota residents pay for fire service through city taxes. Navasota Fire Department responds to calls outside the city limits. However, there is an interlocal agreement with the county which applies to those services. How many calls a year does the Navasota Fire Department make outside the city limits?
It varies from year to year, and I don't remember exact numbers right now. But we run those numbers annually to keep up with that interlocal agreement that we have with Grimes County, because we present that information to them each year during budget. It's pretty consistent, I say fairly consistent, the number that we run out in the county.
Okay. To follow up on that, Brad, does Navasota Fire Department have equipment that the smaller volunteer fire departments do not have that could be critical to these situations?
So in some cases, we do have some equipment that they don't have. We also have full-time firefighters that they don't have, so we're here and ready to go. But yeah, there are some cases, some instances where we would have equipment they might not have. But most of our fire departments in the county are pretty well equipped with really good equipment.
Okay. How far from Navasota does Navasota Fire Department go? Does it go into other counties?
Well, we go into other counties in the city limits of Navasota because we're actually cross over into Brazos County. And then for mutual aid, we'll go a lot of places. We go into Courtney, you know, the city limits or the county line all on this western side. And I don't know, I guess halfway between here and Anderson and Plantersville, maybe Whitehall. Because they've kind of created boundaries, but we're, you know, if they need help, they call us and we go as well. But they've kind of, the fire organization, all the fire chiefs have kind of, in the county, have broken up response areas.
Okay.
All right, here's a nice long question, Brad.
Here's a long one.
The 700-800 megahertz communication system used by emergency personnel, what is it and why use that? How much does Navasota pay for it and the equipment? Is the city renting the equipment or does it own it? Does Motorola have a monopoly or is there a choice on what and where to buy? Does each fireman and policeman and their vehicles have one of these radios? If so, how many? I've heard they can't be used inside a structure, so what do they use inside?
Whew!
Yes. The 700-800 megahertz system is a digital system that we got on a few years back. That system is owned in our area. It's actually owned by Harris County. The Brazos Valley Council of Governments is a member of the Brazos Valley Wide Area Communications System, which we're a part of now as well. But you have to buy into that. So Harris County owns all the major equipment, the towers and all. The city actually owns the handheld radios as well as the radios in our vehicles. We have the handheld radios for all of our on-duty staff. They have that availability. They also have them in their vehicles. We use them inside buildings. I'm sure there could be a circumstance where it might not work, but there could be a circumstance standing in the front yard it might not work. I mean, as with any equipment, things happen, but right now we use it. And this gives us the ability, our police and fire department has the ability sitting right here to communicate by radio with El Paso or Dallas or Houston. So when that's very helpful in our emergency situations, or if we're looking for someone, there's just a lot of need to have that communication. And it's really beneficial to us. It's not cheap, and as far as Motorola, Motorola is their long-standing radio company. I call them the Cadillac of radios. I wouldn't say they have a monopoly. It's probably way beyond my pay grade to determine if they have a monopoly or not. But they do have some really good equipment, and we do utilize Motorola equipment. And of course, some of that goes back to who owns the backbone of this system. They kind of help determine what equipment's used on their system. Okay. Did I answer all those?
I think you did. That's a lot.
That was a lot.
Good job.
Yeah. Okay, Brad. Can you tell us about the margarita?
Short one this time.
It is short.
Okay.
Can you tell us about the margarita shopping extravaganza?
I think you're going to get to have margaritas and shop. But,
Saturday.
Really have a lot of information other than it's this Saturday. I don't know what the time is.
10 o'clock. 10 to 5. Starts at 10.
10 o'clock.
10 to 5.
And so why are y'all asking me? Y'all know the answers.
We were just testing you.
Seeing if I knew what. Yeah. I know to be here Saturday that we're having a margarita walk or shopping extravaganza. I will be here. So there are a lot of our businesses that are involved with that, and it should be very exciting to see another crowd downtown shopping, having fun, and they probably need a margarita to cool off.
Oh, for real.
It might be a little warm.
Yep.
It switched over from cool and rainy to hot, hot, hot pretty
yes,
quick.
It has. So
you might wear your sunscreen and
yeah.
a nice hat. I've got a nice hat I'll wear.
Okay.
Okay, Brad. Application for commercial filming. Has anyone filled out any applications? If yes, who? And am I allowed to know the time and location?
Not recently. Nobody has filled one out. But yes, in the past they have. It's already happened, so you can't go. I was there. I've been there twice. We've had it happen a few times. But yeah, they can find out. Now, it depends on whether they can be there or not. It all depends on what's being filmed and what the requirements are of those folks, because sometimes they don't want people around because it could be dangerous or whatever. But we haven't had a lot yet. We've been a film-friendly city for several years now and keep hoping that somebody will film a big movie. We've had a couple of small movies. We had a music video. I don't know if you remember.
I remember the music video.
That was actually before you came here, Kenny, but we had a music video, Charlie Lucas Band.
Charlie Lucas Band.
So we did that. I remember a couple of other people that came and filmed some stuff here. So.
Okay. So is an application required for non-commercial filming?
No.
Okay.
Brad, is there a difference between rules for commercial and non-commercial, and what is the thinking there?
Somebody got into the movie business here. Well, because with commercial activity, there's going to be a lot of, you know, there's a lot more that come. You may have big stars that are coming to town, you know, and they need to close off streets. Generally, if people are just doing some filming around town, they're not asking us to close streets or do any security or anything like that. So, you know, it's all going to depend. I mean, there may be somebody here that's non-commercial that we may determine, hey, you're going to have to go through the permit process because you're asking for street closures or sidewalk closures or security or anything like that. So there's a lot that goes into it. You know, I think that a lot of times people don't realize everything we have to think about, not just in the filming industry, but of all the things that we do. We have to think about a lot of variety of things that could happen, things that do happen, requirements that people have, expectations that people have. So we try to take all that into account when we talk to folks. And I know that sometimes it's hard for people to understand, but that's what we do.
Okay. If someone wins a big lottery payout, the store that sold the ticket gets a portion. If the ticket was sold in Navasota, would the city also get a portion?
I wish.
Can I get a portion?
I mean, I guess we got the. I don't even think they charge sales tax on lottery tickets, but maybe that person would spend some money in town,
maybe,
and we would get the benefits
that
of that.
Benefit.
So if you win the lottery, shop local.
Invest local. Brad, we noticed the pool did a soft opening this week, and we'll be offering swimming lessons. Are there any lessons for kids 6 years and younger?
I think there is. I need to ask Colton that question. He just said he was going to have swim lessons. So I was assuming it probably, I don't know what the age cutoff is on that. But, yeah, they had a soft opening on Wednesday. Should be fully staffed by next Wednesday and be able to open Wednesday through Sunday.
Okay.
So that'll be a lot
that'll
of fun.
That'll be lots of fun.
Yeah.
Brad, what
Place
is the
cool
cost?
Off.
What is the cost for swimming lessons?
Oh, that's a good question.
$35.
You must have printed that. $35. So pretty cheap to teach your kid
it
how
is.
To swim. And
it really is.
Something that they can use the rest of their life.
My dad threw me out of his boat.
Yeah.
Looks like you made it.
I did. Okay, Brad, if there are questions regarding the swimming pool and swimming lessons, who and where do we call?
They can call City Hall or they can call the Navasota Center. Colton Haffey is our Parks and Rec specialist, but the receptionists also know what's going on out there. Hattie Wells upstairs has a very good grip on what's going on at the in the recreation side. So.
Very good.
They can call us or email us. We'll be glad to answer their questions. Or swing by the Navasota Center or the Navasota Municipal Pool.
Okay. And what time frame will the upcoming downtown assessment be taking place?
It'll be after September, or in September maybe, the fall. We're going to do it in the fall.
Okay.
That gives us a chance to get a lot of these businesses that are in the process of opening up so that they get a full-blown assessment of what we've got going on.
Brad, what upgrades are being planned for the water treatment plant?
Water treatment or the wastewater treatment?
Wastewater treatment.
Probably wastewater because that's what was a big item on the agenda this week. So we've got to replace some rotors, which are the big, if anybody's been out there, they spin and stir the water up and help us to clean that water. We're also changing out the clarifiers. And I'm using all words that probably people don't understand. Without me showing you, it's really hard for me to explain.
So you can't clarify.
That's right. It's so that we will clarify.
Right.
I just can't clarify.
Yeah.
I'm slow, Kenny. So we're doing that. The fine screen out there is getting replaced. There's just a lot of work. That plant was installed, I believe, in the early 90s and really has not undergone any major maintenance work, you know, just daily maintenance. And So you have bearings that are going out, you have metal that has worn out, and it's just time to start work on that. And interesting side note, I met with Paul Malik, the local engineer, today. He was with the firm that actually designed that plant back in the day. So it's just a side note. I talked to him this morning, and he brought that up. So.
The wastewater treatment plant is one of the ones that we visited when we did the Citizens Academy, and it was my favorite stop.
You know, I think of all the Citizens Academies we've done, that, and then, of course, police and fire, everybody likes that.
But
the wastewater treatment plant really catches the attention of the public.
The fire department one was really...
I think people don't really understand that the folks that work in the water and wastewater departments, those folks are really almost chemists. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of responsibility there, and it's really interesting to see what they do.
It really is.
And how they keep you safe and keep your drinking water safe, but also whenever they treat that wastewater to keep it safe, because it goes right back into
Everything that it takes.
The world.
It's just amazing. All the process that it all goes through. It's just,
they do
and they show
job.
All of that, and it's really neat.
Yeah, interesting. They do a really good job. So if you have a chance to get it with our Citizens University, you'll get the chance to go experience it. And it doesn't smell bad out there.
It, not at all. Yep.
That's actually amazing to most people that it doesn't smell real bad out there.
It's really pretty out there.
Yeah, it's kind of nice.
Okay. When will the disc golf course at August Horse be opening?
I don't have an opening date. They just got approved Monday night to begin that work. I did talk to Colton this morning. He went out and he reviewed the layout. He did make a few adjustments. There were a couple of places that he needed to make some adjustments. So I believe that after, since that happened, they'll be ordering their equipment, and of course the scouts will be assisting with that. I think the Kiwanis, or the Lions Club will be helping with that, Parks Board. So
that's gonna
probably
be awesome.
Pretty quick. They didn't talk like it takes very long, so.
I bet they will open
it. We may have to meet over a round of disc golf.
Oh, okay.
That'd make for some good video. I'm good with that. All right.
That was all the grilling
questions. That's all the grilling.
Except,
now the hard questions.
Except, yes.
Yeah, well, first off, this Sunday is Father's Day, so happy Father's Day to all the dads out there.
Happy Father's Day, Dad.
Brad, what was your favorite Father's Day gift you've received? A lot to choose from.
There is.
I get a lot of really cool gifts from my wife and kids, and Father's Day, you know, they know I like to fish. I get a lot of fishing gifts. I can't really pick one. I've got a pretty cool mug in my office that's pretty cool. It's a fishing bobber. Cool.
Something told me it was going to be related to fishing.
The best part is all of us being able to get together.
Absolutely.
I mean, better than any gift that I could ever get is to have Kayla and Kyle and Luke and Mary all at the house at the same time. But and sometimes it happens, sometimes it doesn't.
That's right.
Not going to get to this year. I just spent last week with Kyle and Kayla and Luke and Mary. So.
But for Brad, that's better than sorghum.
That's right.
Sorghum, that's right. I love sorghum.
All right, about
I got some of that the other day, too, as a gift from my daughter.
Good man. Well, we're going to change it up for you, Anna. What is your favorite Father's Day gift you've given?
I think it was, I made my daddy a wallet when we were in home economics in high school. We were like the leather class, so I made him a wallet.
Leather works.
With a little J that I stamped in the wallet, and he still has it today.
Excellent.
So that's my favorite. It was my favorite.
When my oldest was very young, I remember I think she got me a painted Elvis Presley tie.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and it was, I love that thing. So that was that's just one I just always remember. It always sticks out.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
All right.
All right.
Well, thank you guys. We appreciate you joining us for Grilling Stafford again. Everybody have a happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
And come out and join us for the Sounds of Summer, the Margarita Shopping...
Extravaganza.
Extravaganza. And come out and enjoy it. Have a great weekend, and we'll see you next week.
See you next week.
Bye, y'all.